the emblem of suffering and change. For a few minutes, we're going to look at this right here. Exposition on Acts chapter 15. This will be part one of chapter 15. I either lost the last one or whatever. We done had part two and three, so I never did find it. So anyway, some scriptures I have learned since we went through it before, so we're going to rehash this part. Exposition on Acts chapter 15, part one, and this will be message 31. And the title subject is the question of the whole law. And a lot of folks lean on this chapter trying to refute the Sabbath day, the holy days, the laws of God, and they don't understand what they're talking about. It took me years, 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 and years reading Paul's writings. Some statements sound like he's for it, some sound like he ain't for it. And it just takes a while for everything to go together like a puzzle. So we'll start Acts 15, verses 1 through 12, in this part here today. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except you be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you cannot be saved. Now, at the Jerusalem church, where James was the overseer, some are saying there's more than one overseer, maybe, maybe not, but anyway, pinpointed James in Acts 15. And that would have been Jesus' half-brother, overseer of the church at Jerusalem. And there were Pharisees that come out of the Pharisaic religious order and got in church, received the Holy Ghost, got baptized in Jesus' name, and yet they were very zealous to keep the law of Moses even after that. And so they came from, there were certain ministers, they came from the Jerusalem church and they came to Antioch. Now, I don't have the map on here, but you know basically where Jerusalem in Israel is. And Antioch, Syria, which is way north of there. And I don't know why the words say come down and up backwards like we would say it, but they came from Jerusalem and they went to Antioch church where Paul and Barnabas are. So they come up our vision, they have the Holy Ghost, they're Jews. Most up there at Antioch are not Jews. I'm sure there's some there, but there's a lot of Gentiles there. And they have received the Holy Ghost. They have spoken tongues. They have been baptized in Jesus' name. So Luke recorded, and certain men which came down, which actually they went up on the map-wise, from Judea, and they taught the brethren, and said, except you are circumcised, you cannot be saved. Now, they already have the Holy Ghost. They already baptized Jesus' name. So, you can understand. Now, I'm going to show you why you can understand why a lot of people lean on this and say, we don't have to do any of that stuff no more. But that's why we have the title about the whole law. And that's why they're not catching it. They're not getting it. I hope we understand it, and I have to keep going on it so y'all can comprehend it, because it is hard to understand. Even Peter said it's hard to understand. So they were coming up, telling even the Gentiles, y'all got to get circumcised, or you're not going to be saved. Now, they just went to an altar and received the Holy Ghost, spoke in tongues, baptized in Jesus' name. So that's what this is what's going on. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation. When it said they didn't have a small one, what do you think they had? Sounds like an argument, don't it? No small dissension. No small disputation with them. Paul and Barnabas. Now catch this, because Barnabas is going to be led away with this later on. We've done mentioned that in the past. And you think how strong this doctrine was. This is what Paul was talking about when he talked about that other gospel. That was a strong thing going around even then in their day. Now in our day, they've got it twisted around another way, and now they're trying to say you don't have to do any of it. But yet Paul's got writings where he shows we did. So that's why I say we need to look at this real closely. It said they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. After all, y'all come from the Jerusalem church, and you're coming telling us that these Gentiles, now Paul was circumcised back when he was in the Jewish religion, but you're telling them they've got to be circumcised or they can't be saved. And yet they received the same Holy Ghost you have. So Paul and Barnabas and others decided they would go down to Jerusalem church, visit them, and inquire about this that's been taught by these men. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, other towns on the way, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. On the way down, they stopped at different churches. And they testified what God had done, how Gentiles are getting the Holy Ghost up there in Antioch. And when they would come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders. And they declared all things that God had done with them. They declared all things that God had done with them. Praise God. So they done a little testifying on the way. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees which believed. So they were believers that Jesus is the Messiah. The sect of the Pharisees. And like others have labeled them, we'll call this, to be more in the solution of it, the circumcision party. The group in the church that were for circumcision were all of what? You know, there's always been some kind of schism in groups that's in faith. So certain of the sect of the Pharisees that were believers, that believed in Jesus Christ, that had the Holy Ghost, they believed you had to be circumcised. Whereas these others over here said, no, I don't think we do. And they were saying it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. Now, we're going to bear down on what is he talking about keeping the law of Moses, because they say we believe in that, because we do believe in the law of God. So, if they were teaching circumcision, commanding them to keep the law of Moses, did you understand? Because I know a lot of them I've talked to in oneness that fight against the Sabbath and try to use this, they have never comprehended what he's talking about. You're telling the Gentiles, if you're going to preach this doctrine in Antioch, you've got to go all the way over yonder to Macedonia across the Aegean Sea and tell the Philippian church, the church at Thessalonica, and everywhere else, y'all got to be circumcised and keep the law of Moses, which you know what that would mean? Raising an animal, transported all the way to Jerusalem, and sacrificing that animal. And if you catch somebody not obeying the Sabbath, they got to be put to death. If you catch a woman in adultery, she's got to be stoned along with a man too. So when we're talking about keeping the law of Moses, we're talking about all of that stuff. And that's why Paul disputed with them against this. Remember 1 Corinthians 7:19, Paul said circumcision doesn't mean nothing, uncircumcision doesn't mean nothing, but the next step, he said, but the commandments they do. The commandments of God, they do. So, the commandments of God are in the law. Circumcision was in the law. But Paul said, that part don't mean nothing. But keeping God's commandments does, and that includes the Sabbath commandment. And then they'll come back and say, yeah, but the Sabbath day, it was at Sinai, and God done away with that. And we've been proven from scriptures that they had a month and a half knew about the Sabbath. And actually further back than that, because God made it in creation. And then I say, yeah, but what about eating swine? That come from Mount Sinai. I said, then how did Noah know about not unclean animals? How did he know that? And then they lose track and they stun around. I don't know. Because God told them. So there's an understanding that people need to come to comprehend Acts 15. And the apostles and elders came together for to consider this matter. So that was important. Now, I want you to notice while we're doing this, how important circumcision is pressed in this New Testament and the Old. They go to an extent of writing chapters and even almost a book against circumcision. You never find where they spoke against the Sabbath day. You find where those out there try to use scriptures to say it does, but that scripture they're using is not really the way it was meant to be used. And as big as the Sabbath was, you had Jews and Gentiles. In the Roman Empire, where there was a synagogue, when Gentiles come in and join the Jews, they were keeping the Sabbath day. So that was everywhere. And if they were going to do away with the Sabbath, they would have pressed it home like they're doing this circumcision. You find circumcision mentioned just about in a whole bunch of places in here. So here, and when there had been much disputing, just say it, they were arguing. You went down, go down to the Jerusalem church, Paul and Barnabas, inquiring about those that came from there, and there were those in that sect there that believed you had to be circumcised even in that church. So they came together and they began to discuss this, and Paul and Barnabas was speaking against it. Peter is speaking against it here, and later on he's persuaded. But he's speaking against it here. Paul and Barnabas is speaking against it here, but you had this other sect that were arguing and showing scriptures what there are scriptures. And back then, they didn't have the New Testament like we got. They didn't have the book of Galatians. They didn't have the book of Acts. They're making it. Most of them, and from what time this is related to, didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John or anything. All they had was what was called Torah, the Old Covenant Testament. That's all they had to read from and preach from. So you can understand the sect of Pharisees is reading the Torah. Right here it says you got to be circumcised. And Paul and said, no, that's done away with in this right here. So you can see their arguments and where they're coming from. When there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago God made choice among us, that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the gospel, word of the gospel, and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. He's in reference to Cornelius' household. He's in reference to Cornelius wasn't circumcised. He's in reference that God went and sent an angel, told him where he was, come over and preached to him, the Holy Ghost fell on them, and they were shocked that they were getting the Holy Ghost. And they wasn't circumcised. So, that's what Peter was referring to there. And he put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. So, Peter argued against circumcision. Now, therefore, why tempt ye God, Peter says, to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers, nor we were able to bear. Now, I'll give you some quotation of other places. Hebrews 7:19. It talked about under that Levitical priesthood. I had to paraphrase it. Can't quote it straight out. that nobody had a conscience cleared, nobody had been freed from sin in the old covenant. But Paul said, but the bringing in of a better hope, it did, makes perfection. So that's important to think about when Paul said that. He said we don't need to put a yoke upon their neck because our forefathers couldn't do it and we couldn't either. None of us got perfect. None of us got holy by offering up animal sacrifices. Because if these Gentiles are to keep the whole law, they got to do all of this. You see, Pharisees, you're saying once they're converted and receive the Holy Ghost, now they've got to keep coming down here and doing the same old sacrifice and all this kind of stuff. Because that's what was implied about keeping the whole law. But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. Then all the multitude kept silence, gave audience to Barnabas and Paul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. I'm sure they had a story to tell about the miracles. I know Paul, what did he have? Raised a man from the dead that fell over my third loft. I'm sure that was brought into that testimony. There was another man where Paul was preaching. He perceived he had the faith to be healed. He said, stand on your feet. The man stood up that was lame. So they had different things to witness and testify about. And no doubt more than even that. And they declared the miracles and declared the wonders that God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. Now we're going to go back to some other scripture settings as we read through that part right there. So we see the sect of the Pharisees are saying you've got to be circumcised and keep the law. And again, their reference is to keeping the whole thing just like the Jews. Everything. Everything. Galatians 2:11 and 13, but when Peter was come to Antioch, is talking about the same thing in Galatians. Let's break off where we were. They were at Jews of Jerusalem Church. Paul and Barnabas telling Jerusalem Church what miracles God had done by them. Peter was there, stood with them, sided with them, against the sect of the Pharisees that we call the circumcision party, them that believe you need to be circumcised and keep the law. Time goes on, Peter goes up to Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas are now. So Peter goes up there. When Peter was come to Antioch, Paul says, I withstood him to the face. What happened to Peter? Because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, we're talking about those teaching circumcision and keeping the whole law. Prior to their continual teaching and indoctrination, Peter would eat with the Gentiles. Before those came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. When they were come, he withdrew and separated himself. Peter done that. Fearing them which were of the circumcision. So this was a big thing going back then and a big dispute among Christians. Nowadays it's Godhead stuff. Mostly. Peter was persuaded. Notice that. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with Peter. With him. Insomuch, Paul got a problem. His buddy, companion, Barnabas now. Remember Barnabas and Paul went down there and disputed with them of the sect of the Pharisees teaching circumcision? Peter spoke against it in Jerusalem. All of a sudden, Peter comes up there, visits Antioch. Peter is trying, is doing, and Paul has to stand right there and rebuke him to his face. And he said, other Jews dissembled with him. Insomuch Barnabas also was carried away with our dissimulation and wouldn't partake and eat with the Gentiles. Fellowship them, in other words. So they were being persuaded. Barnabas was persuaded by them. Galatians 2:16. See, they get this twisted around today, and they think that's what we're talking about when we talk about keeping the laws of God. They think we're talking about you got to be circumcised. They say, are y'all trying to build on the law? Even that group over here, the UPC and that other church, they think that's what we're saying. They don't separate this stuff. They don't understand this stuff. And Peter said, Paul's writings are hard to be understood. Here, catch on to this. Galatians 2:16, Paul said, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law. Now, look how many times he mentions works of the law just in this one verse. No man is justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law. And Paul said, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. The old covenant could not make anybody perfect. Doing the whole thing will not make you perfect. So let's catch on to what he's talking about. What are those works of the law? Now I'm going to read you one example. And I hope you catch on to what he's talking about. Works of the law. Figure yourself how you would like to do this every time you committed a sin. That's what they were teaching. Leviticus 4:2-12. God spoke to Moses, speaking to the children of Israel, saying, if a soul, one man, shall sin through ignorance, he don't even have to be willfully doing it. Just be forgetful. Boy, we all be in trouble when we've had to have a good thinker. Forgetting stuff. If a soul shall sin through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done. If you do it through ignorance, and shall do against any of them. Or if a priest that is anointed do sin, he'd have to do the same thing before he can do the job to help you out. Remember what I said Paul wrote down about priests on earth have to offer sacrifices for his own sins and then the people's. He's got to get himself right through the sacrifice offering before he can go do somebody else's. Jesus don't have to do that. He's in heaven. If any man sin, we go to him. He takes care of it. If the priest that is anointed do sin according to the sin of the people, like this guy up here, then let him bring for his sin, which he has sinned, a young bullock without blemish unto the Lord for a sin offering. Now we're going to go through step by step what you got to do if you had to do it. You say you sin, a soul sin through ignorance against any God, any commandment. You had to bring a young bullock without blemish. Which means you've got a pen around your house somewhere that's got bullocks in it. Different animals. You got to feed them. You got to raise them. You got to make sure they birth right. You got to make sure they're fed right. You got to make sure the bad dogs, wolves, whatever else, don't come in there and steal them and kill them and all this kind of stuff. You got to do that. Does that work? That's just a start. All of a sudden you realize you committed a sin against God's commandments, even through ignorance. Oh, I forgot about it, didn't know it. Wasn't no mercy and grace in those days. Remember that. You had to go out there and look through the pasture. There's one more he's living. You can't get him. Can't get that one. I eat him later. You go through and another and got something. Can't get that one. You got to find one without a blemish. Then you got to catch it. I don't know how big a bullock is. I don't even know what it's in reference to. I've never seen one. I don't know if we're talking about a bigger cow or something in the middle. Sometimes I need to look that up and get what they are. But whatever it was, even if it was a sheep, whatever kind of animal that was, they had to round him up. Whether it be you could do it by yourself or get a friend or one of your kids. You had to round. This is just for you. This ain't for your wife. It's not for your son. It's not for your daughter. You done this. You got to round that little creature up. Tie him up. Put a leash on him. However you want to do it. You got to put him in a wagon and walk him all the way to Jerusalem. That's the only place God accepted sacrifices. So that's work. That's the start. That's work. But you're not done. You just started. That's called the one seed. He shall bring the bullock unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord, shall lay his hand upon the bullock's head and kill the bullock before the Lord. So you bring him up there. If I'm understanding correctly, I don't think the priest does this part. You bring him up there and you lay your hand on its head. And you take a knife and you slit its throat. Because he had to see it. It's going to bay or whatever it does. A bellow or something. And you got a pan down there. Catches its blood. And it takes a while for it to drain out. And until it dies. That's work. That's something you got to do. Get your sin. Now, I'm talking about keeping the whole law. Telling the Gentiles in Antioch. Telling the Gentiles in Macedonia. Y'all got to bring them all the way across the Aegean Sea and go over here and sacrifice. Now that you're in. And the priest that is anointed. He didn't got himself cleared. He's got his robe on. He didn't been sanctified. He went through the process. Now he's got a job to do. Now that's work on him. He shall take of the bullock's blood and bring it to the tabernacle. So he picks it up out of that tray. He carries it over there to the tabernacle. Probably get a little heavy. I don't know how much blood it was. To the tabernacle of the congregation. And the priest shall dip his finger in the blood. And sprinkle the blood seven times before the Lord, before the veil of the sanctuary. He's right there, there's the veil. He sprinkles that blood. A man had blood all over the place while he's sprinkling blood. Now just think of this for this priest. While he's taking care of this one guy, here come five people in there that haven't had a sin in their life. And they got to get rid of that sin. They're lining up. They're getting ready to do the same process. Kill another animal. Maybe there's more priests in there. Take care of that dog. He's doing his job. Soon he gets that done, he got to go get another one. That's works. Something the oneness and Trinity don't ever look at here when you read what Paul's talking about. That's the works of the law, and that's what Paul said we don't do. And when you get this done, you're not done. You're not done now. And the priest shall put some of the blood upon the horns of the altar of sweet incense. Now, I don't know where that would be in the tabernacle, but he'd have to walk over here to the horns of where the sweet incense is and take of that blood and put it on the horn of the altar. He had to do that. Which is in the tabernacle of the congregation. He shall pour all the blood of the bullock at the bottom of the altar. Of the burnt offering. He'll take that blood and pour it out right there. And that ain't just one, they'll bring another later on. Which is at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. See, he'll walk all the way around and go back to the door. He shall take off from it all the fat of the bullock. How you gonna get all that fat off? What do you think? You gotta get your good knife, fillet knife. And they probably didn't have good fillet knives back then like we got now. For the sin offering, the fat that covers the inwards, all the fat that is upon the inwards, how you gonna get to the inwards? That's just that one sin. You gotta take that animal somewhere and slice him open. You gotta find the fat inside that animal. The two kidneys, the fat that's upon them, you find where his kidneys are. You slice the fat off of it. Which is by the flanks. The caul above the liver with the kidneys, it shall he take away. So he takes that part out. And it was taken off from the bullock of the sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest shall burn them upon the altar of the burnt offering. So where he poured out that blood of the burnt offering, now he got to take that part, put it over where the burnt offering goes. Now besides that, let's stop there a minute. How are we going to burn that on the burnt offering? You got to have a fire, but you got to have something. Ain't hell like we got nowadays, punch a button, fire come on, did it? What does that mean? Somebody had to go out there and get some wood. Somebody had to go out there and cut trees down. Somebody had to haul that wood into the area there, unload it where they could keep that fire going. Work. Works of the law. And all this right here is not going to take sin out of that guy's heart. So he poured, the priest shall burn them upon the altar of the burnt offering. Now he still ain't done. He still got that animal sliced up. He just took the fat and other stuff over. The skin of the bullock. All his flesh. His head, his legs, his inwards, and his dung. Don't you know that stunk? Even the whole bullock shall he carry forth without the count. Now look back. Can't look back, yeah. He took the fat. He put it upon the altar of the burnt offering. That's one place it's burnt. That's inside this thing. Okay? He ain't done. He takes the skin of the bullock. He takes the flesh of it. His head, his legs, his inwards, his dung. The whole bullock shall he carry forth without the count. Now he's got to pick that thing up. I don't know if he had it in parts or what. And carry it outside. Go to a place. A clean place where the ashes are poured out. Besides that, now think again. Well, they're burning that stone. There's ashes collecting there. At one after the other. One after the other. Somebody's got a job of work to go in and pull that pan out that's got them ashes and carry it out there and pour the ashes out, bring it back in, put it back in the thing for more sacrifices. More sacrifices. Works of the law. That's what Paul's talking about. They've got to constantly do this stuff. And then when they carry this bullock with all that other stuff, that legs, the head, the inwards, the dung, and all that, to the clean place where ashes are poured out and burn him on the wood with fire, somebody's got to get cut wood and carry it out there at that place where the fire is going. Another fire is going. This other was offered up to God, but that part just been burned up. It says, well, the ashes are poured out, shall he be burnt. That was over. If any man sin, S-I-N, one sin, transgressed the laws of God, broke a commandment of God. Now, that's what the circumcision party is advocating. That's what when it says, you've got to be circumcised, you can't be saved. And you've got to be circumcised and keep the law of Moses. In reference to what we just read, if that would have been so, if that would have been carried on, we would have to be doing this here. They'd have to do it in Hickman. They'd have to do it in Union City. And they'd have to do it in Fulton. They'd have to do it in Dyersburg. Everybody where there's a Church of Jesus Christ is getting the Holy Ghost. We still have to have animals. We still have to offer sacrifices. Paul said no. But that's what it's talking about, keeping the whole law. Leviticus 7:37, this is the law. That's just one sacrifice. Look at all the different ones you got listed. The law of the burnt offering, the law of the meat offering, the law of the sin offering, the law of the trespass offering, the law of the consecrations, and the law of the sacrifice of peace offerings. All kind of different sacrifices for different things. They all had to be done, just what we read. Chopped up, cut up, burnt, fire built, this, that, and the other, constantly. That's just for one man. And the priesthood, they were lining people, lining up. They would have been overworked if the Gentiles had started coming in there, and they didn't want Gentiles in there now. I'm thinking what they're saying, when a Gentile come in and join the synagogues, if they would be circumcised, they could go into the temple. They accused Paul of bringing Timothy into the temple, and he was uncircumcised. Now, Paul didn't do it, but they accused him of that. But this is the law of the burnt offerings and all these sacrifices. Back to Galatians 2:21, and here Paul goes on, I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Nothing they done through those sacrifices made that man that committed that sin any better. You know why he had to offer the sacrifice? Because he transgressed the law of God. People are not understanding and comprehending the distinctive difference about the what's called the Mosaic law of the sacrifices, because if everybody walked perfect, they wouldn't need that sacrifice anyway. If everybody walked holy, they would not need any penalties, like somebody being stoned, somebody get 39 stripes on their back, or whatever penalties involved for breaking God's laws. There's differences in this. And Paul said, if righteousness come by the law, because they're preaching to keep the whole law, get circumcised, even after you get the Holy Ghost. Paul said, if righteousness come by the law, then Jesus died in vain. Nobody doing those things were perfected. Paul wrote Hebrews 7:19. But now they're saying, well, once you get the Holy Ghost, now you can break God's laws. You see how they've got this twisted? Satan is cunning. He's got a lot of folks believing they don't have to worry about God's Sabbath commandment. He's got them believing they don't have to worry about whether they eat swine or not. That's why they had to do the sacrificial laws, because they were sinning. If they committed a sin, they were transgressing God's law. And that's why they had to do that sacrifice. Now, it's hard to break that down, but you can comprehend this. Galatians 3:19, Paul said, wherefore then serves the law? It was added because of transgressions. How many understand that little thing right there? I know it's hard to, but think of what I'm saying. When he says this here about this law, talking about the Mosaic law of Mount Sinai, why was it added? It was added because of transgressions. All right here we have a little thing laid out here. You got from Adam to Moses, there were sins. Ever since Adam killed Cain, killed Abel, was it? themselves were born. From Adam to Moses, sin was increasing. Now remember, we fall back on again what John said sin is. Sin is the transgression of the law. Talking about God's law. Now Sinai's over here, we ain't got Sinai, but over here without Sinai, they were still sinning. They're still breaking God's laws. Paul said God's laws are spiritual. Whatever God hates, he's always hated before he ever made Adam. And he will hate when the last sunset rises and everything. He will still hate that certain sin. So mankind began to sin right here from Adam to Moses, but there was no road signs up saying you're sinning. You understand it? You can be breaking the law going down the road. It may be 55, but there's some places it is more. There's some places it's less. You may be going down the road, you come along through there, and you may be doing 55. Think that's okay. You may just pass the 45 zone. You're doing 10 miles over now. You don't know that because somebody might have stole the sign and put it in their house. People do that, you know. You cruise along there and you feel pretty good. I'm obeying the law, but you ain't obeying the law. Next thing you know, you look up in your mirror and there's a blue light. What do you want? Wonder who he after. I did that one time. I was doing 90 mile an hour. State trooper in Illinois was passing me. And I looked up and I seen that red, there's a red light there. That red light was flashing and he was fixing to pass me. I looked up in front of him and wonder who he's after. I looked down in front of me on the big old highway and there wasn't nobody but me and him. I looked down my speedometer sitting on 90. I said, uh-oh. I said, I know who he's after now. He was trying to pass me and tell me to pull over because I didn't. He had it on. I didn't notice. So anyway, all of this time from Adam to Moses, sin's been committed, but they don't know God's laws. They don't have penalties. They don't have nothing showing them that they're doing wrong. It's just in their conscience. So we come to Mount Sinai, and God come down on Mount Sinai, and Paul said, I had not known sin except the commandment had said, thou shalt not. I would not have known lust except the commandment said, thou shalt not covet. That's what Paul wrote. So, when that Mount Sinai laws begin to be put down, and just because you know you're committing a sin doesn't mean you're going to stop sinning now. If you don't believe that, get out there on that road doing 55, see how many pass you. All of them know it's 55. Your lawmen know it's 55. You can watch them pass you sometime without that blue light on. They're breaking the law. Because I've seen them do that before. A couple of years ago, even there at that time, a sheriff vehicle passed me. And I'm sitting on 55, speed law. He comes around me, and I thought, well, I wonder how fast he's going. I speeded up and cut pace with him, watched the speed off. I went to 70 miles an hour, he's still going up. He crossed state line down here, turned off some road, went back to somebody's house in Tennessee, and he's from Kentucky. I thought, well, he's breaking the law, but yet if I'm doing that and he sees me, he'll have to throw that blue light on me and tag me. You know, and back in them days, when they had, just because their law is exposing their sin, does not mean they're going to quit their sin. Here's what the Jewish religious order, Paul said, they stumble at this stumbling stone right here. God said, when you commit a sin, we just read one example. You've got a certain sacrifice to do. They got to believe in that's all you've got to do. If you commit a sin, just pay the sin. And then keep on doing what you're doing. And do it again next year. Do it again next week. If you've got enough animals. And you keep on doing your sacrifices. Your sin is exposed, but you're not getting it out of your heart. Now, do you catch on a little bit of what's going on? under that old covenant, Paul said, if righteousness come by the law, that Jesus would be dead in vain because he would not have had to die if we could have got righteous by that law. But nobody got righteous by the law. They kept sinning. They kept sacrificing. They kept taking penalties and getting 39 stripes and other things. And go right back out there and break more laws again. And they thought, this is routine. This is it right here. God, and they never went any further in obeying God than that right there. So, Jesus comes along and dies on the cross to remit those sins. And you see, the sacrifice of Christ was the cure for violating God's law. They're breaking the law here, don't know about it. And all of a sudden, the law exposed it when it said, thou shalt not, and you find yourself doing it, you know you were committing a sin. Now, under the gospel, when we get in Jesus Christ, when we repent of our sins, when we're baptized, all the past sins are wiped clean. He grants us the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is to lead us and guide us to all truth. Where Paul said we lay aside every weight of sin. And I'll say it again. Breaking the Sabbath is a sin. Because it is a commandment of the Almighty God. And just because that woman got caught in adultery, and Jesus said, you know what, I'm giving you a break today. That does not mean God done away with the thou shalt not commit adultery. It does. It's still there. It's still a sin. They would have been stoned dead. We don't stone them. Somebody said, why? Well, if you're going to keep the law, well, that's what we call it. We want to keep the Sabbath and keep the holy days, and we reject the pagan demon days. Y'all try to build a law. I said, y'all don't know what you're talking about. You have no idea what you're talking about. And that just makes them worse. They don't know what, they think they know. They don't. And when you commit that sin, we don't have to go and kill somebody for breaking the Sabbath. Like under the law, they were put to death. Moses stoned them. When somebody committed adultery, stoned them. Somebody said, y'all believe that? So you go back. I said, no. What Paul say? The Lord said, vengeance is mine. I'll repay it. We have been brought grace and mercy. We have been given a break. We know that all this sin is still sin. But now through the gospel, God has given us opportunity by giving us the Holy Ghost power to refuse the evil, to choose the good, to take every weight of sin and put it aside, put it away, and put more of the attributes of Jesus on until we get closer and closer and closer to the perfect state that he talked about. And in this new covenant, if you commit a sin ignorantly, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Now it also talks about if you willfully sin, after coming to the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice, but a fearful looking for a judgment. So see, sin is still there. Sin is the transgression of God's law. That ain't done away with. The sacrifices are done away with. The penalties are done away with. We have a new high priest in heaven that takes care of us while we're growing. Galatians 3:21, is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid, if there had been given a law, if there had been a law given, which could have given life, Paul said, verily, righteousness should have been by the law. But there was no law given that can make you live right. None. And that's why Paul said, spoke about this faith in Christ. That's what can help us overcome it. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, he is debtor to do the whole law. You go to your sacrifice. I won't want to go through all that. Romans 3:31, Paul said that we then make void the law through faith. And the original version says that we nullify the law through faith. It's a real question. In the Greek. Do we nullify the law? See, they're saying it's done away with. Even the UPC brothers over here and in the First Pentecostal Church say the same thing. It's done away with. Because they've got that mindset different than what we got. They think all it means is get the Holy Ghost speaking tongues, and that's it. That's about you finished it all when you've done that right there for the rest of your life. And that's not true. First of all, them that Paul and Barnabas and all them guys talked to, all of them had Acts 2:38, every one of them. What were they arguing about then, if it didn't matter? Second Peter 3:16. Here's what Peter said after looking at all this. As also in all his epistles, talking about Apostle Paul, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood. Y'all catch that? Some things are hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable, they rest. They rest. Rest. As they do also other scriptures. And what they do to this? Under their own destruction. Under their own destruction. So Paul's epistles are hard to be understood. If they rest them, they're unstable, they're unlearned about what's going on, and they get it wrong. They do it to their own destruction. Contemplate what Paul said. Now, first of all, I put down, don't forget Ananias. You remember one old Paul, blind eyes? What was he? Bible said. A devout man according to the law. So evidently he wasn't resting it to his own destruction. He opened Paul's blind eyes. Jesus said, go down there and open his blind eyes. And yet he's a devout man according to the law. So who's in trouble with their destruction? Who's in trouble resting the scripture to their own destruction? Them that are not keeping the laws of God. Them that are saying it don't matter no more. Why do you think Jesus Christ said there'd be a move in the last days that would deceive the very elect if possible? How close do you think you'd have to be to the truth to do that? How close do you think? You think somebody go out there and baptize Paul so the Holy Ghost could be close enough? I don't think so. You think somebody that just said Jesus Christ, Son of God, is close enough to deceive the elect? Don't think so. You know who could? Then they teach Acts 2:38. They can see Paul's hard sayings, rest the scripture to their own destruction, because in the bottom line, they're teaching their people, it don't matter. You can do what you want to do. You're free. You can break the Sabbath. You don't have to honor any holy day. You can take care of Christmas, pagan holidays. You can have Easter. They'll do that at this church over here that you watch when Easter comes around. Once you get Acts 2:38, you have been given the Spirit of God to lead you to the truth. And we're supposed to come to a place where we can 100% obey the Almighty God. Praise the Lord.